Havlicek steals it! Havlicek stole the ball!
Out of rural Mississippi, from a Division II college, he burst on the NFL scene like a new star from an unknown galaxy. But we knew him soon enough as a player. Strong, fast, shifty, and unafraid, he was a lover of physical contact, trading sting for sting with the biggest and the baddest, while carrying the football farther than any man in league history. But for all his talent, the man called Sweetness remained as elusive off the field as he was on it. Here is an attempt to define Walter Payton beyond the numbers.
The most fun I've ever had was playing football. And I don't care how many records are broken or anything else, they won't have as much fun as I did.
He was Sweetness, he was light on his feet, he was, the numbers say, the greatest runner in NFL history. And tonight, Walter Payton is gone.
Here's a guy that was invincible, and all of a sudden, you find out that he's not.
When you see someone that you think is at the peak of his life and health, you don't believe that it's possible that someone that's that vibrant can go so fast. And I think that's what shocked us all so much.
I got a little girl, she's 4 years old. 10 years from now, when she asks me about the Chicago Bears, the first thing I tell her about is Walter Payton.
Throughout the National Football League, we're going to honor Walter Payton's passing with a moment of silence. Sweetness, thank you for touching us all.
I've talked to a lot of people in Chicago, a lot of people around the country about Walter. And one of the sayings that I've heard is that in Chicago, Michael Jordan is loved, Walter Payton is revered.
I think he really was a symbol of everything that Chicago likes to think it stands for. Hard work, struggle, seizing the moment.
I think he represents someone who just really loved the game, the competitive spirit that he had. He could relate at any level to anyone.
I know that I love him, as you all know. But I loved him before I met him. Because I saw something in the way he played football that was special. He was a warrior. He was a gladiator. He was up to the challenge. He wasn't backing down from nobody.
Payton refined his combative talents in relative obscurity. At Jackson State, he rushed for over 3,500 yards, scored 66 touchdowns, and kicked extra points and field goals. Over four seasons, he amassed a Division II record 464 points.
I saw Walter Payton run through the line, and his helmet hit this tackle's helmet, and it bust. I saw him stiff arm defensive back as they came to tackle him and actually snap the head back and the feet almost leave the ground.
Drafted fourth overall by the Bears in 1975, Payton launched his 5'10", 200-pound frame at the NFL that fall.
Hands it off to Payton. Big hole up the middle. To the 10, to the 5, to the end zone. Touchdown!
When I see him out there, it gives me goosebumps. Not the speediest, not the quickest, but that durability. And to keep pounding, you know, week after week after week, play after play after play.
Receivers left and right. The toss to Payton, sweeping right. He's got some blocking. Makes the turn, 40. 35-30, right sideline. 25-20. They go all the way. 15-10-5. Touchdown!
I think the genius of Payton was his creativity. whatever you plan to do to stop him, to take away one of his strengths, he would turn around and find another hole in your defense where you had to compensate.
He had one thing that he loved to do and he was so good at, is he finished off a run. You came up, boom, he was going to get you.
He spins back inside, ripped by one man, still on his feet, struggles away at the 20, still battling, breaks away at the 15, the 10, the 5, and down to the 4-yard line.
He revived the art of the stiff arm, and he was popping people who wore face masks. It was a very risky thing to do, but Walter perfected it.
Walter was a nasty little son of a gun. He really was. Walter challenges your courage.
McMahon, the handoff, Payton taking it to the left side, breaks through to the goal line, touchdown!
He was relentless in the fact that he just didn't go down easy, you know, and if it was between you and the sideline, you better be ready, because it's going to be you.
There are a lot of guys who are great runners. Maybe they can run and catch the ball out the backfield. But this guy could block.
Walter Payton just put him right on his butt.
He could throw the ball.
Quick pitch to Walter, fakes the end around. Walter's gonna throw! Man wide open, touchdown, touchdown!
He was a complete player.
Walter Payton to me is the best football player I've ever seen. And I was fortunate, you don't coach Walter Payton, just give him the ball. He'll do all right.
Blessed with a near-perfect physique, Payton did just fine every game day of his career, save one in his rookie season.
God looked down on Walter Payton and said, Walter, you're going to play for 13 years, and you're going to miss one game, and they're going to beat you up and knock you down, and you're going to get up and still play.
Payton almost missed a second game in 1977 against Minnesota. Instead, he rushed for 275 yards, an NFL record that lasted 23 years.
I was sick. I had the flu, and I didn't feel like I was going to play. Had a little temperature. I was throwing up. I told him, you know, heck with it. I wasn't going to play it.
I remember him telling the coach, I want to go. I want to go. Next thing I knew, end of the game, 275 yards later, Walter was, you know, the man.
Of all the records set by Payton, the most difficult was passing Jim Brown's career rushing mark of 12,312 yards. When he pulled within reach in 1984, each yard gained seemed to grow a little longer, a little tougher.
Pain in the butt. Because every day, you know, the closer you get, you know, everybody goes, oh, this year, man, you got a chance to break the record. Yo, you're close.
Payton's work today left him just 66 yards short of Jim Brown's record.
That's probably the only time in his entire professional career when he actually felt the pressure. When the numbers start to crunch in and the media starts to hounding, and you can't get away from it.
Everybody's watching you walk into some places. Yeah, you won't break Jim Brown's record.
High formation, quick pitch to Walter, looking for the record, cuts back, he's got it, he's out of the 25 and the 26 yard line. Walter Payton becomes today's Football League all-time leading rusher, surpassing Jim Brown, and that's the equivalent to Hank Aaron breaking Babe Ruth's all-time home run record.
This is a lot of pressure, and I'm just glad that I don't have to do this every week.
He was not a braggart. He was not a strong personality. He's a rather humble person.
Hello.
Hello, how are you, Mr. President?
Congratulations again, and good luck on the next 12,000. Very best wishes. Congratulations again.
Well, thank you, and give my best to Nancy.
Walter is as great as anybody that ever lived that played the game. His heart is as big as anybody ever played the game. His work ethics were as good as anybody ever played the game. It all speaks for itself. That is Walter Payton.
Born in Columbia, Mississippi on July 25th, 1954, Walter Payton grew up at the epicenter of the civil rights struggle when two centuries of racial injustice was defended by fire hoses, attack dogs, and tear gas canisters smoldering across the Jack Pines.
The fear was so thick, the oppression was so intense. You had these parallel institutions set up, white and black. The blacks' institutions were almost never funded. And so you had a real fascist state.
There are a lot of problems in Mississippi like there are all around the country, but when we were growing up during that time, we really weren't aware that most of them existed. I mean, there were great people who were non-Afro-American in our community that took an interest in us.
We lived probably until we were in our early teens before it really hit us that there was this vast difference between white and black because we lived in our own world.
People look at Mississippi as being very racist, but Mississippi is a place where people are people. If they like you, you know it. If they don't like you, you know it.
Here's Walter Payton coming out of that nexus and saying to all America, well, you know, race just didn't hit me in the face. And I think in Walter Payton's case, he was in a cocoon, and the cocoon was that very strong mother and father. They always wanted to keep the family cocoon intact and protecting Walter.
Reluctant to leave their children alone, the Paytons sacrificed their time together. Edward worked days and Aileen nights.
They basically had nothing in terms of material things, but I do know that they had a lot of love.
Our parents really cared enough about us to discipline us so that when we were not with them, we knew wrong from right, and we knew what the outcome would be if we did the wrong thing.
We all had a week to wash dishes. And if the dishes were not washed correctly, you were awakened out of bed and washed the whole dishes over. And I mean everything, the ones that were dirty and the ones that were clean too. So you learn to do the job correct the first time.
Our parents stressed being well-rounded as kids, and we were forced to go to music, forced to go to piano. Music has always been a big part of our life.
Sweet Walter Payton from Mississippi.
Walter.
The dancers in the house were Walter and myself.
As they say, a little shake, a little bake, and a fast exit.
3 years before Payton's national TV appearance on Soul Train, he played drums in his high school band. But when his mother lifted her ban on football in his junior year, he found new purpose, setting records at all-black Jefferson High. Then, in 1970, Payton was part of the first class to integrate Columbia High School.
And everybody was worried, how would these two races mix? Opening game of the season, Walter takes a handoff and runs 95 yards for a touchdown. He goes 65 yards on another run for a touchdown. Suddenly, everybody in town isn't worried about whether you're white or black. You're part of a team, and that team is what was important in that little town.
We played Prentice, which was a rival, you know, once we were integrated, and Walter scored two touchdowns. And he gave what some call now the black power signal. He held up a clenched fist. Someone approached me after the game, wanted to know, what's he doing giving the black power signal? I said, well, if he can carry the ball like that, he can give a black power signal anytime he gets ready.
At an early age, Walter saw something that we could not see. He had a vision for himself. And he not only had a vision, he lived out that vision.
But I think Walter was one of those guys where he was saying, you know what, I'm somebody. I'm going to prove it. Every practice, every down, every play, I'm going to prove it.
Payton's drive to prove himself never was more evident than in a rigorous training regimen he developed in college.
We used to run the bleachers a lot, run up and down the bleachers, and then Walter found him a hill and run, you know, where he could run down the hill almost as fast as he run up the hill.
He had his version of the Matterhorn, and that's what he would run up. And he would have teammates who would come out there, and they'd try to match what he was doing, and they'd be dying. They'd say, let's get to the golf course. Let's get to the swimming pool, you know, where, give me a gin and tonic. Give me anything but this.
Basically, you ran till you puked. Be 100 degrees, 110% humidity. Just do that again and again and again.
A lot of times, after they got through running the hill, it took about 15 to 20 minutes before I could drive my car home.
Walter knew that he had to be ready to be the best. And I think that that also sits in the back of your mind and makes you realize that you can't miss a workout. You can't miss a step.
In his second NFL season, Payton hit full stride, running for almost 1,400 yards. And in 1977, he won his only rushing title with 1,852 yards and the MVP. On top of the football world, Payton was emotionally leveled in December of 1978. His father, Edward, died in a Mississippi jail cell.
My father died of a brain hemorrhage. When you're bleeding up there, it kind of takes away your equilibrium. Your functions that you have, they're no longer there.
His sister told me that they had picked him up and carried him to jail because he was drunk. And, you know, I said right then, I said,
I knew he wasn't drunk, because I've never seen him drunk. So I went down there to get him, and he was dead then.
An autopsy found no alcohol in Edward Payton's blood. Despite a ring of suspicious circumstances surrounding his father's death, Payton was philosophic when the Columbia police were cleared of any wrongdoing.
Who's to say that in the same situation, if I would have been looking at a white guy and me being the police, I wouldn't have made the same assumption. You want to get angry, you want to be mad, or you want to, you know, lunge out at somebody else, but what my father and what my mom taught me, teaches me, is totally different from that.
I'm sure there would have been people, given his financial wherewithal, who would have been glad to stand by his side and scream bloody murder. But that wasn't Walter Payton. That wasn't the boy that his daddy raised. The boy that the father raised was the boy who would put on the blinders and go back to playing football.
You and I must make a pact. We can bring salvation back.
Hello. Yes, it's me, Michael Jackson.
To see him run, to see him block, and to see him do all those manly things on the football field, and then he'd come off and it'd be this high-pitched voice. It was like a Monty Python skit sometimes.
I guarantee you it's unlike any other exercise tape you've seen.
He'd always come up to you, usually in a public place, and maybe give you a little pinch on the backside. And you'd look around and say, gosh, this macho running back is pinching me on the backside or whatever. You know, what gives here?
He had a hand like a pair of pliers, and he'd come up behind you, and he'd grab a piece of meat on the back of your thigh and would not let go, and he'd send you right through the roof. And you really hadn't made it as a sportscaster or a sports writer in Chicago unless you'd been pinched on the butt by Walter.
When he'd run out of bounds, he would goose a photographer on his way by. He was famous for, you know, if he was laying on the ground underneath a pile, tying the referee's shoes together.
Payton sneaks up behind me and wraps his arms around me and lifts me up off the ground. And as he does so, there's this crack. And Payton says, see, Enberg, I put your back in place. I said, no, Walter, thanks. You just broke my glasses.
Something was going down. 90% of the time, Walter has something to do with it.
About 2:30, 3 o'clock in the morning, the fire alarm goes off. Well, of course, everybody's asleep. Walter comes out of his room and says, what's going on? What's going on? Well, everybody knew. Matter of fact, I think the police and the fire department all went to Walter's room.
We had a general manager who was a very serious man, Jim Finks. Walter's the only person I knew that could reduce Jim Finks to rolling up socks and running around the locker room, throwing them at each other.
Walter, if he was feeling like it, would head up to the switchboard and sit down and start answering the phone.
They'd say, oh, where's Ms. Johnson? And Payton said, she's on vacation. I'm taking her place.
When I was off the football field, I kind of felt like I was unclothed. I kept everybody else laughing. I kept them off guard so they didn't notice that I was not on the football field.
Very, very sensitive guy. I remember one year he cried when he was injured. He came off the field. He hurt his ankle. And, you know, you don't see that from a guy. It wasn't that he was hurt. It was that his pride was wounded.
But when it came to revealing himself, Walter always backed off. He was notorious for setting up interviews and then running away.
I had set up an appointment with Walter for after practice one day in Chicago. I'd flown in expressly for that. I approached him and I introduced myself, and he told me to meet him in front of his locker. What he did was skip out the back door and left me standing in his locker.
Oh, Walter was just playing out there. You know, he had the attention span of a cabbage moth. If you had to interview him, it had to be on the run. He always had to be going someplace. There were ants in his pants.
And when you're playing with athletes, you're in a locker room with these guys, these are your guys you go to war with. Those other guys are looking for a story. You have to deal with them, but you distance yourself from them, man. Walter, just don't let anybody in his world.
There are certain things about yourself that you don't even like about yourself. And you definitely don't want anybody to find those out.
Walter was really kind of an enigma. I think those of us who were around him for all of those years never really knew him.
There's no question it was Walter right, Walter left, Walter up the middle. He was the Bears' offense.
Well, I mean, you know, it was pretty easy to figure out how to key on the Chicago Bears. We were always limited somewhat in the passing game, and you knew that you had one great running back and you were going to run him to death.
He had to be a marked guy.
and people are going to go after him, and he still put up those kind of numbers.
Over his first seven seasons, Payton rushed for just over 9,600 yards. Yet the Bears managed only two winning seasons, both of which resulted in quick playoff exits.
Last 3 weeks, I've really taken a beating. A lot of those shots that I took, I'm walking back to the huddle and my head's still ringing. Mm-hmm. And then he calls me to play again. And
how long can this keep up?
Not long.
Yeah. Yeah.
Not long.
Walter Payton on every play was taking a pounding. Every play.
Relief was on the way. In 1982, Mike Ditka was named head coach, and quarterback Jim McMahon was drafted in the first round. By 1984, the Bears were in the NFC Championship game. A year later, they went 15-1 and suddenly were the hottest act around.
That 85 Bears team was one of the most astonishing teams in the annals of sport. You had more characters on that team than I can recall on any sports team before or since.
There was something for everybody. You know, you had Ditka on one side, the outspoken coach, Buddy Ryan on another, had like the feud there, and then McMahon on one side, Walter Payton on the other side.
The Bears manhandled the Giants and Rams to earn a berth in Super Bowl 20. In his 11th season, Payton finally had approached the mountaintop. But just as he was about to touch ultimate victory, he was overshadowed.
Here was what could have been his supreme moment, the guy who'd been sheltered from his deserved accolades for so long. And now, everyone is writing and rushing around to see the punk quarterback who mooned the people up in the helicopter.
The fridge walking down Bourbon Street, you know, with 1,000 people behind him, and, you know, all these incredible moments. We couldn't keep up.
Somebody said to Walter, "What do you hope to achieve in the Super Bowl?" Well, the obvious answer is to win the game, to have a championship ring, to score a touchdown, to lead my team to victory. Walter said none of those things. Walter said, "I want to play the game so hard that when it's over, I'll be exhausted. I don't want to have anything left mentally or physically."
Super Bowl 20 drained Payton to the bottom of his reserves, but not for the reasons he anticipated.
High formation backfield. Here's the handoff. Payton shatters that to the right side. Fumbles the football as he hit. And the Patriots have recovered, it appears, at the 19-yard line.
Walter had got hit with the fumble in the first series. So I think mentally it kind of took him out of his game.
Well, we gave the ball to Walter quite a bit. And New England's whole focus that whole week was to stop Walter Payton. And they did a pretty good job of that.
Despite holding Payton to only 27 yards on 11 carries, New England trailed the Bears 23-3 at halftime.
You knew the Bears were going to win the whole second half. My hook as an announcer was, will Payton at least get a Super Bowl touchdown?
I mean, you got the premier running back in the history of football. Don't score a touchdown in that game, something's wrong with that pitcher.
Payton and, again, William Perry in the backfield. First and goal from the 1 yard line. Hand off to the Prince. Yes, William Perry has scored on a 1 yard touchdown run in the Super Bowl.
Why would you want Fridge to score? I mean, no, Walter's supposed to be in that end zone.
Here's the crowning achievement of his career as a team player, as a Chicago Bear. And he doesn't get his piece of the wedding cake. That was cold.
It ticked me off. The way it was handled, some of the words that I want to use that come to mind at this particular time, I can't use.
When you're playing a football game, you don't think about who's scoring touchdowns or this or that. And then in retrospect, you say, well, it was important. You should have thought about it. You know, that's something that I should have thought about and should have made sure that happened.
I just don't think that Mike Ditka had an obligation and really even realized how important that would be to Walter Payton.
Walter Payton got to play in the Super Bowl. He played very well. His team had one of the great Super Bowl victories ever. Walter Payton played on one of the great football teams in National Football League history. A lot of great players never got to say that.
He doesn't want to appear as if scoring a touchdown was more important than winning the game. But in a blowout situation, there's no question he would like to have had that honor.
Still puzzles me how that great team only won one Super Bowl. I mean, just A lot of things had to go wrong for them not to win more than one.
We should have won 4 Super Bowls. Unfortunately, mentality and the focus of the team was not totally there.
The next year, everybody had endorsement deals. Everybody had new speaking engagements and book opportunities.
Outrageousness.
And suddenly, instead of all being focused on having a great time and winning a Super Bowl, people had new agendas.
We just blew it. Man, we just blew a great opportunity. We really wanted to go back to the Super Bowl. Just didn't happen.
What do you say about the year of the Chicago Bears? They had distractions, they had all kinds of problems, and now what's been a tumultuous season for Chicago switches over to what will probably be as tumultuous an offseason.
After a first-round playoff exit in the 1986 season, Payton made a decision that brought Chicago to a standstill.
Unless something happens and Ms. McCaskey comes to me and says, we'll come back next year, it looks like this will be the last one.
Payton rushed for his last 533 yards in 1987 as Chicago won a fourth straight Central Division title. On December 20th, the Bears honored the greatest running back in their history. Sweetness reciprocated.
I guess the only thing I can say now, thanks for being there. Thank you.
Walter's retirement left you wanting more, but that was the way he wanted it.
In January of 1988, the Bears faced Washington in a divisional playoff game. Trailing by 4 with 41 seconds left in the game, the man who accounted for almost 22,000 yards came up a yard short.
I remember looking down from the press box and seeing him there and thinking, my gosh, you know, all the things he had accomplished, everything he had done, he looked so lonely.
He was completely destroyed that his career ended this way. He thought he was going to end up playing in the Super Bowl.
It's been a lot of fun. And when you take away the fun, then it's time to leave. That's why it's so hard for me to leave now, because the fun is still there.
In the locker room after the game, one of the writers there had asked a question that kind of indicated to him that this writer believed he had hung around too long. And Payton said, all these years, I still get no respect.
Payton once in an interview said, beneath this breast beats a heart. It bothered him a lot that he wasn't getting his recognition.
People talk about running backs and everything else, and they never talk about me.
You paid more for flash and style than performance today, and Walter, made his reputation on hard work and consistency, not flash, not so much style. And, you know, when you do that, a lot of times you overlook or you take him for granted.
You'd like to know the most typical Walter Payton kind of thing that had to do with his breaking Jim Brown's record. It was in October. The Saints were in Soldier Field. But the Cubs were in San Diego in the National League playoffs. It's not fair to say that Walter Payton broke that record in anonymity. But Chicago's attention was certainly divided, shall we say. He had to share the moment with the Cubs.
What we should remember Walter Payton for is the consistency of his play and his durability, his endurance, his willingness to fight for the tough yard. He didn't get easy yards.
He wasn't the combination of speed and power that O.J. Simpson was. He wasn't the electrifying open field runner that Gale Sayers was. He wasn't pure dominating power like Jim Brown was. He was just damn good.
As far as being the fastest, I wasn't. Being the strongest, I wasn't. Being the biggest, I wasn't. I had something that nobody else had. I think I was the smartest.
Do you want to own a brand new HP, Dell, or other name brand computer and improve your credit at the same time?
No longer able to directly feed off the excitement generated on the football field, Payton looked for new venues to challenge his competitive spirit.
I'm not sure if he really ever liked it. He needed something else to do, and I think he thought that car racing would fill that void.
More than anything, what race car driving gave him was a thrill. He loved interacting with the public, which it continually gave him. It gave him media exposure, which he also knew was good for him.
Walter liked to hunt, and he had a gun. He had a Luger in his locker. He would shoot at birds up in the trees with this Luger.
And his motto was, if it flies, it dies.
Payton's post-gridiron pursuits may have provided some thrills, but his need to compete was met primarily in the fields of business, where he flourished.
Walter's success was partly due to the fact that he was very entrepreneurial.
When you ask Walter, hey, what are you doing? You know, you better be ready for about a half-hour conversation. He had several restaurants and nightclubs and bars. He was putting together a group to bring arena football back to Chicago.
And he was very popular on the motivational speaking circuit, and that was continuing to build, and he was deriving a very good living from that.
Payton was always ready to put his money where his mouth was. And when NFL owners voted in 1991 to expand their ranks, he and his partners were among the first in line.
He looked at St. Louis as something that was a long term, that he could really sink his teeth into, that he would truly be passionate about.
We were watching some Bronco tape. He goes, you see those new helmets they got on? I said, yeah. He goes, they stole my logo. That was my logo. It was going to be the St. Louis Stallions. I mean, he was involved down to designing the uniforms.
I think the challenge of being the first African-American to be owner of an NFL franchise was very exciting to Walter. And the fact, too, that the lead thought that he was worthy of being an owner. And it was disappointing that it didn't happen because they put a lot of time and a lot of hard work into it.
What it basically came down to was something completely out of Walter's control. It was two of the other partners who didn't get along.
When the proposed St. Louis franchise fell through, Payton turned in another direction, the Walter Payton Foundation, a nonprofit organization devoted to inner city children.
Had a heart for kids, really had a heart for people, and always looking for an opportunity to make a difference in the lives of people less fortunate.
One of Walter's most famous traits was that he would ask the businessman if they had children. And if the businessman said, yeah, I have children, he'd say, well, let me see them. Give me your wallet. I want to see the pictures of your children.
And boy, would he just give them a ration if they didn't have a photo. He wanted people to be proud of their children.
Payton made his own children especially proud in the summer of 1993 when the all-time leading rusher with 16,726 yards was inducted into the Pro Football Hall of Fame by his 12-year-old son, Jarrett.
Not only is my dad an exceptional athlete, he's a role model. He's my biggest role model and best friend.
It would mean a lot, first of all, having the opportunity to go into the Hall of Fame. And I think for Walter, it was just a way of passing the baton of manhood. It was maybe a way of just saying, you're my son and I'm proud of you.
We made a wager who would be the first one to break down in tears. And after hearing my son get up here and talk, I don't care if I lose the bet.
With his football legacy in place, Payton's future shimmered like gold on the horizon. Soon, the shadows will begin to gather. In the summer of 1998, the man whose body was regarded as a paragon of health began experiencing bouts of fatigue.
The first sign of a liver problem came in 1990 when he was going through a standard physical. They looked at his liver and they said, your liver's not quite doing the right things. And you know, Walter being Walter and Walter being a great athlete and a physical specimen, ignored it.
He would complain occasionally of having stomach problems, and we thought it was indigestion or something like that. He took a lot of Pepto-Bismol and Maalox, and it must have helped because he'd never felt that he needed to see a doctor.
In December of 1998, after undergoing an exhaustive battery of tests at the Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota, Payton was diagnosed with a rare and potentially fatal liver disease.
That evening when he got back home, he brought me downstairs and without the kids. He was very calm when he broke the news to me. I know he had sugarcoated it quite a bit to tell me, but the first thing I did was cry because I got scared. I got really scared.
Jarrett Payton has his news conference announcing he's going to go to Miami, Florida, play football. And suddenly there's Walter, and his appearance was shocking. He had lost 25 or 30 pounds. Our reporter on the scene asked him before the news conference started, gee, you know, Walter, why don't you get some clothes that fit? Well, you know, what the heck's the matter? joking with him, and he said, you know what, I overtrained for the marathon.
No one had ever approached me and said anything to me about the weight loss, not even my closest girlfriends. I think we all knew it was probably just a matter of time, because how can you explain something like that? How can you explain that amount of weight loss?
We do the story on the air, and I'm reading my voiceover, and we show a shot of Walter, and I say, gee, you know, look at Walter. Man, he looks like Gandhi. I think I could take him. Ha ha.
It's like somebody stabbed him in the heart with a sword. It was devastating to him because the media had never really attacked Walter before. They had never said anything negative.
My style on and off the air is I'm a real wise guy. I'm a real smart aleck. And this time it really came back to bite me. I was absolutely devastated. I tried to call Walter immediately and he wouldn't come to the phone. He was too upset.
The people that were making jokes and all these other things, I don't think they had a clue what Walter was going through. You know, out of ignorance, sometimes we do things and we say things, but who would think Walter would be sick, needing a liver transplant? Who in the world would think that? I wouldn't.
It's very sad that in this era, that you think AIDS, let's say it, that you think he drank himself to death, that you think drugs.
It sort of made him angry that now he had to go public and explain to everybody something that he really felt was just his business.
I think when he first went into the press conference, he was really going to try to stay just matter of fact and tell people that, you know, give me my time. At that point, you could have heard a pin drop, because I think people realized Walter's not getting ready to announce a new business venture. Something's going on here, and it's serious.
To the people that really care about me, just continue to pray. And for those who are going to say what they want to say, may God be with you also.
He leads a great and exemplary football life. And now he feels, because this is America, and we demand to know every single thing about every single celebrity, that a guy who has always shown us the best of himself and his sport has to call a press conference to reassure us that he didn't get this disease by doing something bad. He said, pray for me, and I'm thinking, you know what, pray for us all.
One night, my office, I'm working on the show, and the phone rings, and it's this familiar little elfish voice saying, you know, you're a hard guy to get a hold of. And I went, oh, Walter. And he said, hey, look it, man. You know, you didn't know. You had no way of knowing. And I've known you for 17 years, and hey, you know, I forgive you. Forget about it. I was just very emotional at the time, and I couldn't talk to you. I hung up the phone, and I was just absolutely stunned. Again, here's a man who knew at that time he was dying, and he went out of his way to call me, to forgive me. That's one of the greatest gifts I've ever received in my whole life.
At the Cubs home opener in 1999, Payton threw out the ceremonial first pitch. What no one knew, not even Payton, was that he was making his last public appearance.
There was no reason to think that anything else was wrong other than he needing the liver transplant, that he should be fine. So that's what we held on to.
Tell all the people I appreciate their prayers here. They're one for their prayers, and they're walking around now. Keep them going.
Up until that time, in very late May, he was still a candidate for transplantation. And it was at that time that we found out that he had tumor outside the bile ducts and outside the liver and in the lymph glands. So that meant that he would not become a liver transplant candidate.
Please consider signing your donor card and make sure you discuss this with your family. Thank you.
Walter Payton did that spot without telling anyone that he would no longer be saved by a transplant, that was not going to save him. And to me, that really said something about the man.
In my heart of hearts, he never, ever threw in the towel. He never said goodbye. He never said, I know I'm not going to be here.
We just take it a day at a time. Didn't know what each day would bring. But again, you kept hoping, beyond hope, that, you know, it would be okay, that things would still work out.
By October 1999, it was apparent that things would not work out.
I just went in and I just talked to him a bit, and I looked at him. It was a new expression, a new peace, on his face, a peace that surpasses all understanding.
We're here, obviously, with a very heavy heart. Walter did pass away at approximately noon today at his home with his family there.
You are resting in peace, for there is no pain, there's no sickness, no sorrow. One day we will all join you. I recognize that millions of people will miss you because of what you've done on the football field and the lives that you've touched. I will miss you because you are my dad.
Give to Payton. Payton spinning off tackler. Jared Payton still going. Jared Payton's first touchdown as a Miami Hurricane as he takes it in from 16 yards away.
What a terrific run by Jared Payton as he points to the sky to remember his father, Walter.
It was kind of emotional because I knew that he couldn't be there, but he, you know, he saw that, you know, where he was, and it made him proud.
The one thing people should remember about Walter was his optimism and his ability to always look forward, not look back.
He was such a strong person, always being there, so caring. I just think everyone should know that.
I think mostly of Walter when things weren't going well. You know, when he was around and give you a little hug or a pat or a kiss. That's what I remember more about Walter Payton.
As a kid from Columbia, Mississippi, to have touched this many lives, Walter said, you know, not many of us get a chance in life to really realize how many people we've touched. I've been given that chance. I think Walter would have been shocked in death how much greater that was.
Walter Payton's death was hard to accept, not only because it was so premature, but because, like Lou Gehrig, it defied an image of godlike durability. Like Gehrig, Payton was a quiet man who was forced by a terminal illness to open up to the public. Not surprisingly, the public and private image proved much the same, even at the brink of death and beyond. In 1999, the NFL Man of the Year Award was changed to bear the name of Walter Payton. For SportsCentury, I'm Chris Fowler.